To our Savior's worship. If you're new, we're glad that you've joined us today. And for those of you who worship with us regularly, welcome back. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear God, thank you for joining us in our worship. Bless us as we pray, sing, and hear your word read and preached, that we may grow in our faith. Amen. Let us now confess our sins and receive the forgiveness of our Lord in Jesus' name. Let us pray. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us take a moment to confess our sins to the Lord, and then I will speak the words of our communal confession. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin, and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We'll be right back. first reading this morning is from the Old Testament book of Genesis, chapter 18. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre, as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. And he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. The word of the Lord. Our gospel is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 10. Now as Jesus and his disciples went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary, who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." The Gospel of our Lord. I invite you to join me in a word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you that your word enters into our minds, our hearts, and our lives through listening and through reading. We ask that it grow there, that it may then fill our lives, and through our lives, our words and our actions, go out into the world as your good news of love and salvation. Amen. Hospitality is wonderful, isn't it? I truly think that being hospitable and receiving hospitality are two of the great gifts of life. I actually believe, especially as a Christian, that the willingness to invite someone into your home is an act of love. In the same way, accepting another person's invitation of hospitality is the other side of the coin. Allowing yourself to receive hospitality can be as important as the giving of it. In the giving and receiving of hospitality, relationship happens. Friendships are formed and love is active. No wonder Jesus sat down and shared a meal with so many different people during his ministry. Sometimes I ponder upon all of the hospitality that I've received in my life. I try to remember the different dinner tables at which I've eaten, the innumerable sofas that I've sat upon, and the various pillows that have cradled my head over the years. Frankly, at this point, there are too many to count. Yet certain incidences are very memorable. In 1991, I traveled into the mountains of northern Mexico with a group of young adults to the small village of Villa Manero. During our week there, we worked on a construction project for the local church. I remember that first night, us men were led into the small church building to find that the pews had been moved against the walls, the floor swept, and we were to sleep upon the floor of the sanctuary in our sleeping bags and sleeping pads that we had brought. I was so tired that the floor truly looked welcoming and inviting. The next morning, we walked next door to the back patio of the adjoining house to eat breakfast. And lo and behold, set up on the patio was a full-size poster frame bed that looked like it had recently been slept in. Us guys glanced at one another with quizzical looks on our faces. But we did not learn the why of the bed until the women joined us for breakfast. Then we were told that the family, church members, had given over the entirety of their home so that the women could sleep on their floor. But to do that, the couple had needed to move their bed outside, and so they slept in the open on their patio. Now that is true hospitality. A little over 10 years later, my wife Emily and I were traveling through Karelian Russia, visiting fellow Christians in the region around Europe's largest lake, Ladoga. We had been going from church to church with an American church group that supported the nascent Ingrian Lutheran Church in Russia. On this trip, we stayed in hotels, except for one night. In the city of Kontopoya, upon the shores of Lake Onega, we were hosted by families of the local Lutheran congregation. Emily and I were hosted in the home of a family of four, who lived in a small Soviet-style apartment of two rooms and a kitchen that also had a toilet and washroom. The older child, a teenage son, did most of the translating for all six of us as we ate together and shared stories of our lives. Our shared Christian faith helped us to leap over the cultural divide and find commonality and joy in our conversation and fellowship together that evening. When it came time for us to go to sleep, surprisingly, the father, mother, and daughter left their home to go sleep at her sister's home, and so leaving us with their son as host for the night. They had done this so that Emily and I could sleep in their bed and have the privacy of their room. What a gift of love was that family's hospitality. And it's a gift that I've obviously not forgotten. Yet not all gifts appear because one receives, but can also happen when one gives. We have given hospitality to many people too, and have thus been blessed through the sharing of the gift of love. In the winter of 2002, on a night in which the temperatures fell to negative 32 degrees in the forests of northern Minnesota, Emily and I hosted two men from a church in the country of El Salvador in Central America. I mention the cold because these men were bewildered and even frightened by its intensity and the white world of snow and ice in which they found themselves during this visit. So we not only offered them warm beds, but the warmth of Christian fellowship as we all shared in a stumbling conversation in a mix of half-learned English and Spanish. Though we struggled, we laughed and learned and shared. We connected. In none of these stories that I've told do I especially remember what we ate or how clean was the room in which we sat. No, what I remember is the conversation, or even more, the intimate, loving feel of the fellowship given and received as humans sat down and shared of their thoughts and experiences. I remember the sharing of our lives and the creation of loving relationship. In truth, what I'm describing is what is at the heart of Christianity, because it is at the heart of Jesus. Love given and received. Relationships formed and lived. For is Christianity not truly the relationship between humanity and God, brought to completeness in the love of Jesus? It is the love offered us by Jesus and shared in relationship. It is this which we see in the short story from Luke's gospel. Martha, we read, is working hard to host everyone. Jesus, his disciples, her brother Lazarus, we assume, possibly other men from the town, maybe even some of the women who were part of Jesus' retinue, and her sister Mary, we learn. Usually we assume that Martha's busy making the meal, and maybe she was, but perhaps she was cleaning up afterward. Who knows? But the focal point of the story is that Martha is upset because she is doing it all on her own. The hospitality has fallen upon her, and I think she feels that the hospitality is not complete until every dish is dry and the table is clear and clean. And to Martha's irritation, there sits Mary, listening to Jesus like there's nothing else to do. She is sitting there like she is his disciple, like she's a man, like she is allowed to do that. Finally, Martha cannot take it anymore and confronts Jesus with the situation. What does Jesus do? Jesus tells her, and so tells us, what is most important. As Jesus puts it to Martha, there is need of only one thing. That is to do as Mary is doing, to sit with Jesus, to be in relationship with him. Like Mary, we need to sit at Jesus' feet in faith as his disciple. We need to sit and listen and learn. We need to respond in prayer and questioning. We need to be moved and changed by his teachings. We need to wrestle with what we have learned. We need to hear his words of grace, peace, and love. Jesus is the one and only thing that we need, first and foremost. This is where we start. This is where we should always start, sitting at Jesus' feet, growing in relationship, basking in his love, like Mary did. There is only one thing, Jesus said to Martha. Jesus is it. In the end, there is only Jesus. Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and also the end. He is, he was, and he is to come. Jesus is all we need and more than we can want. Accept his hospitality and fellowship, and give him the same, a space in your life. It doesn't need to be all cleaned up, and dinner doesn't need to be perfect or gourmet. And definitely don't think that the dishes need to be done and the table wiped down before sitting down and giving him your attention. Simply sit, listen, learn, grow, be forgiven and forgive, be loved and love, and know, believe, there is only one thing, and Jesus is it. Amen. Let us confess our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. Dear Jesus, I thank you that you offer each one of us your hospitality by calling for each of us to sit at your feet as your disciple. And remind us, there is only one thing, and that is you, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, we need your presence and the faithful presence of your people in the world today. We pray for peace amongst the peoples of the world, the factions of our nation, and between neighbors in our communities. Help our leaders, elected or appointed, to remember that they are called to be servants of the people rather than wielders of power for power's sake. Correct them where they are wrong and strengthen them when they are right. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of healing, we give to you our sick, those living with a health condition, fighting a disease, or wrestling with emotional or mental health. We pray for your presence with all whom we hold in our hearts, who need your healing presence. Please give to all who are grieving the death of a dear one your solace in their sorrow, your peace on their journey. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Walk with us, your people, as we try to live lives that can bless the world and its people. Lead us into our days, O Savior, as we try to live lives of active and living love through our words and our actions, that the world may know you and that you are the one thing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give to you, O God, all these for whom we pray, trusting in your grace and mercy. Amen. Let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One quick announcement, really more of a request. 16 high school youth and three of us leaders, including me, will be heading off to Alaska in 3 days to go up and serve through the ministries of the church up in Fairbanks, Alaska. We'll also have a few days to hike and see Denali. But I want to ask you to pray for travel mercies, for us to be blessed, and for us to be a blessing, for us to learn and to grow, as well as to share of our time and talents. So if you could keep us in prayer all the way through the end of the month, that would be wonderful. Thank you for that. Now receive the benediction. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord's face shine upon us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with favor and give us peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord by serving your neighbor. Amen. We thank you for joining us today. And if you have any questions about our Saviors, Lutheran and Hastings, please visit us at www.osel.org. You'll find a lot of information there as well as our contact information. Thank you for joining us today. Have a great day. Bye-bye.